because welcome back to Ministry Revealed. It is September 8th, 2023. And in today's shareables, yeah, that's what I'm going to call them. I'm going to call these shorter videos shareables to help people give a deeper understanding or receive a deeper understanding of what the prophetic scriptures are telling us that I'm sharing in the YouTube shorts. You can, from here, go and follow the bigger teachings. I mean, they run anywhere from 2.5 to 3 hours, some of them, but they go very much in depth. And I promise you, it is worth your time. But this will help you go a little bit deeper. If you have any questions about those shareables, something's triggered you to say, well, wait a second. Yeah, I've wondered about that before. Or this never made sense to me. I wonder what more there is. So this is one where a lot of people have been asking and saying, man, just because you show 14 years and this above 14 years in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and what Paul says, what makes you think that that is the revelation of the end of days? Well, as those who have been around for a long time know, that's where it started. That's not where it ended. That is just the beginning of the understanding once you understand first and foremost who the Gospels are speaking to. Once you begin to realize that Luke is pre, Mark is mid, and Matthew is post, you see that Jesus is wearing a gorgeous robe in Luke towards the crucifixion, and it means gorgeous, white, radiant, like a bride. That Mark is, he was arrayed in purple, and Matthew, he was arrayed in scarlet, and they're both tribulation colors. These details are all prophetic, and the closer and the deeper you dig into them, the more you're going to realize these differences. It's been happening and being revealed here for 6 years. That's how powerful it is. And every time something new is found, and there have been hundreds of them, they connect to the exact same time frame that every other piece has connected to. So as you study this, as you begin to understand what we're going to share today, more to prove out this 14 years and take it all the way back to the beginning, I want you to then dig into this right here. This is the playlist tab right here on YouTube. Come and listen to this one right here. Just listen to the first 4 videos. It's a 22-minute video, 30-minute Bible study, 30-minute Bible study, and then about a 2-hour and 45-minute video. And the reason for it is because it helps you understand how this was all missed. And the answer is it's all because of Matthew. All of our foundations have been based on the Gospel of Matthew, whether we've realized it or not. Because in the Synoptic Gospels with Mark and Luke outside of Matthew, they've been looked at as just added information that we go to once in a while. But there is way more, and that is only the is. The is to come is the prophetic revelations within them that reveal who the Gospels are speaking to, which is what then led me to find what Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 was talking about. But I'm going to show you where else it takes us. So let's get into this. In fact, I'll start you too with showing you the intro page on Ministry Revealed. You'll see that it was the same as the intro right here. You can go to the Ministry Revealed website, go to the intro page right here, and here are your first 4 videos in order. This is the 22-minute intro that discusses briefly the next 3. There's your 30-minute one about who the Gospels are speaking to. There's your 30-minute one to begin to give you more understanding of the 14 years. And there's your It's All Because of Matthew. Then you can start to go much deeper in the ones that follow. All right? So let me show you this. First of all, in Isaiah 28, we read this in verse 10. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. So what does that mean? What does that mean? Does that mean we can just take all of Scripture and say this whole thing means this? No, it's saying there's going to be some here, there's going to be some there, but it's got to line up. It's got to have the same typologies of details within them. That's what it's telling us. Well, what else do we read? In Ecclesiastes 1:9, a favorite one that I go to a lot, the thing that has been, meaning was, Old Testament, from the beginning of creation until Christ, the thing that has been is that which shall be, Does that mean everything Old Testament is going to replay exactly like it was? No. Here a little, there a little. And then it says, and that which is done, which means from Christ until the moment of the pre-trib, that which is. So you have the was and the is that we can take from a little here, a little there. You see what I'm saying? That there's evidence and there's prophecy and there's typologies in the was and in the is that reveal what? The is to come. That's what these things are telling us. And that's what I'm going to show you. See, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 2, we read, starting in verse 2, that Paul says, I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. Whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. Let me show you what that means. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. You see, when you have a program like this, where you can have the Strong's Concordance at your fingertips, everything begins to open up. Here it is, such an one, the Greek word 5108. It means like. So it's like what? Like a caught up. What is the word caught up? It's the word harpazo. It's the word rapture that people talk about. So there is one that starts everything in a period of time of those who are in Christ that's going to happen in a period of time called above 14 years. And for the longest time, I didn't know what it was because it's only given to us as above. But in this above, it's got to be less than 15, or it would have said above 15 years. So the mystery for a long time, we know it now, but the mystery was, what is this above period of time? The rest, though, is very clear. 14 years. So a period above and then 14 years. And what does he say about this group above? It's like a rapture. So this first one isn't the great multitude rapture that everybody believes, but it's one similar to it. And they're the ones in Christ who are going to go to the third heaven. Then he says, I knew such a man. So now it's not the same as the ones in Christ, but it's like, you see, similar, but they're not the same as the ones that were in Christ that went to the third heaven. Now people say, oh, this is Paul talking. These are experiences Paul had. Yes, they're experiences Paul had. But it is prophetic, here a little, there a little, in the was, the is, both revealing the is to come. And when you begin to understand and take the time to see these things, to pray over them, to dig into them, you will see them for yourself. Because most people skip over this first one because it's like a caught up. But they like to come to the second one and listen to what it says. I knew such a man. Whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows how that he was caught up into paradise. So this is the was caught up. This is the rapture that everybody knows. What is the was caught up that everybody likes to point to and talk about? First of all, we can see it's not the first one. It's the second one. And where is the second one? Well, the first one we revealed in a short. In recent shorts, and we've talked about it right here. It's before the travailing in pain, travailing in birth. Okay, we talked about that. The answer is found in Isaiah 66, verse 7. So where's the was caught up? In Revelation 12, 5. Look at that. And her child was caught up. This is the great multitude rapture. So when is it? It's in the seventh year of seals, where the great multitude is now before the Lord. That's why it's between the sixth seal and the seventh seal. It's in the seventh year. And you say, well, how do you know it's the seventh year when we go into 2 Corinthians 12? Right off the bat, you don't know. You just know he's telling this story from a perspective at the end of 14 years and a little bit of time that was before it. And it's giving us prophetic insight. So you have the pre-trib above this 14 years, we're going to get into it, which is a period of time of 50 days. I'm going to show it to you. You have the was caught up, which we know happens between the sixth and seventh seal, which is 7 years of seals and 7 years of trumpets, as you'll come to understand, is his 14 years. This was caught up to paradise is the great multitude rapture, as I said, in 2 Corinthians, in Revelation 12, verse 5. And then you keep coming down and listen to what he says in verse 14. behold, the third time, I am ready to come to you. So we saw the first one was a taking, the second one was a taking, and the third one, he's coming to them. And what does he tell them? I will not be burdensome to you, for I seek not yours, but you. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. You see, they are enduring. It's Judah enduring till the end. We're in their time. We're in their portion of time of flesh. It is their 6,000 and then what? The 7,000th year millennial reign for their promise. But what does the church get? What do the Gentiles get? Pre-trib, third heaven, great multitude, rapture, going to paradise. Both of those are part of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven is when he comes the third time, which is when he returns feet down on the Mount of Olives, and the millennial reign then begins. All right, let me show this to you. Let's go back over here. We see, let me break down this portion of time that's the above. All right, we'll briefly break it down. We see it here, and this story is only found in Luke. This is, again, what I was saying. There is always a reason why certain things are only said in certain Gospels and why other things are said, but they're said slightly different and sometimes very different in the same story, is because they're giving us insight prophetically. It's not because the scriptures are corrupted. It's not because these differences are discrepancies that are to be disregarded. They are prophetic insight. And listen to what he tells them, starting in Luke 12, verse 35. He's talking to a group from Luke. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning, and you yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding. That when he cometh and knock, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily, I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to eat and will come serve them. So there's a group that after he returns from the wedding, the Gentile bride's 7-day wedding, that he's going to come and meet and he's going to serve with and have a meal with. Then he says, and if I shall come in the second watch or the third and find them so, blessed are those servants. So what do you see? This is the first watch. There's your second. There's your third. Well, that's interesting. A pre, a mid, a post, a taking, a return. But there's three watch groups, meaning there are three remnant workers that will remain. The first one that will work during seals, the second one that will be there during trumpets, which is the 144,000, and the third one, a group of the 12 through the tribes that will be out throughout the millennial reign. It's all throughout scripture. And it's the gospels that reveal this to us in the very last portion of each gospel in their final chapter. Okay? So who is this group that he's going to sit with and eat and have a meal with after the wedding? Well, if we go to Luke 14, look at what we see. We see a wedding story being given to us in Luke, not in Mark, and at the end of Matthew. Why do we have it in Luke and in Matthew? Because there's two weddings. There's the Gentile bride and his Jewish bride. Mark is not part of the wedding. So we see here in Luke chapter 14, verse 8, the one to the Gentile bride. It says, starting in verse 8, and when thou art bidden to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room, lest a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him. And he that bade thee and come and say to thee, give this man place, and thou being with shame, take the lowest room. But when thou art bidden, go sit in the lowest room, that when he that bade thee come, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher. Then thou shalt have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. This isn't that same one. This is at the wedding. For whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. So I always teach in the ministry, those who go pre-trib, sit in the lowest room when you get to the third heaven. Then said he unto him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or supper, call not thy friends, not thy brother, neither thy kinsmen, neither thy rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again and recompense thee. Okay, now listen to this. When we go into this, let me go into it in Luke chapter 14 in this program called eSword, so you can see these differences in words. Here is the wedding feast that we were talking about. What we're finding now here is not a wedding feast, but a banquet. So here's the wedding, the picture, the typology of the pre-trib, a little here, a little there, in the is being given to us of the Gentile wedding that is the pre-trib portion at the beginning of the above in the 50 days. Then what do we have? Then he's going to have a banquet. Do you know there's no great banquet in Mark or in Matthew? This only happens in Luke. Why? Because in Luke chapter 12, he told us that when he returns from the wedding, he's going to have a meal with a group of remnant bride people that were chosen to remain to serve him during the time of seals. We read about it in Romans 8. And listen to what it says. It's all over here. Verse 13. But when thou makest a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. And listen to what he says in verse 14. And thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee, for thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. This resurrection of the just are those who will be putting their necks on the line for the churches of the Gentiles that we see in the picture of Priscilla and Aquila, who put their necks on the line for the churches of the Gentiles. They are a representation of a remnant Luke bride portion that will work, serve Christ during the time of tribulation. And we see when they put their necks on the line, who are they in Revelation 20? They are the ones who took not the mark. They never bowed to the Antichrist, never worshiped his image, and they get to be resurrected to rule and reign with Christ as priests during the millennial reign. So you're seeing this group right here being different from this one that went pre-trib. See? So this is them. But where else do we see them? Let's keep going. Where else is this period of time? Let's go to Luke chapter 24. And I'm going to explain. This is all part of the 50 days above the 14 years. And here's this group. These two on the road to Emmaus. So this is in Luke 24 when he returns from the wedding. So the 7-day wedding means he's coming on the 8th day. And listen to what he does with these people. With these two. You only read this, by the way, in Luke 24. You go to Mark and you go to Matthew, and neither of them does he sit down to eat with and serve. You see the typology? It's built right into it. In Luke 24, verse 30, and it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. You only read this in Luke's story in the final chapter, not in Mark, not in Matthew. We see then he opens the scriptures to them. He ends up opening their understanding of the scriptures. This is a picture of what the Son of Man is going to do when he comes during the 40 days after the pre-trib escape and after the wedding, 7 days, when he comes on the 8th day during those 50 days. Listen to this. Let's now go and show you where these 50 days begin. So what you're going to see is we just saw this above and 14 years broken down as a pre, mid, and post and an above portion in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. How can we figure out this above portion by going to the Gospels? Well, when we come to John, we see the resurrection of Christ. She says, don't touch me yet. I haven't ascended to my Father. And then what does he do? He comes back the same day at evening, and he meets with his disciples. He breathes on them the Holy Ghost, and guess what happens? He vanishes. Thomas wasn't there. Now Jesus is gone. And he returns what? He comes back after 8 days. What do we know? So at the beginning of the 50, the pre-trib is gone. Those above 14 years going to the third heaven, those in Christ. He returns after the wedding, like he was telling us in Luke, to meet with the people to be girded about. And what does he do? He first meets with the apostles. So this modern day apostles that will begin the end of days. And there's your eighth day. What does he do on this same day after he meets with the apostles? The story then goes into John, goes into Luke. In Luke 24, you have the picture of the road to Emmaus. You have the two on the road to Emmaus. He sits with them, eats with them, serves them. He opens up their understanding. And then he tells them, that they're going to now go and be in Jerusalem. They're going to receive this this anointing from the Holy Spirit. And from this anointing, they're going to go and preach beginning from Jerusalem. So we go then from there. So this is all the eighth day. And then while he's there with them for the next 40 days, that start on the eighth day. We go into Acts chapter 1. And we see that the 40 days have come to an end. They're waiting for the anointing to come from the Holy Ghost after the Lord leaves on the 40 days. Okay? You're going to see the Son of Man is going to be here for 40 days. And the enemy's books even proclaim it. And he tells them when he leaves, we know that they're what? Not many days hence. So you have 8 days, 40 days, and it leaves what? 3 days to 50, right? The 48th, 49, 50. Now listen to this. Not many days hence. And what happens in Acts chapter 2? In Acts chapter 2, bang, Pentecost, not Feast of Weeks. Feast of Weeks comes 50 days before Pentecost. And so Pentecost, there's the Holy Ghost. They receive the anointing, and it's the time of new wine. So this, it's always about mid-September to very early October. That's new wine, which means the pre-trib in the 50 days started before new wine, 50 days before new wine, which is true Feast of Weeks. You following? This is very important to understand. So what do we have here? We have 7 days, then the 40 days begin. And then we have not many days, which is about 3 days. And then the dove or the Holy Ghost comes. And then what do we have? Then you have Paul's remaining portion, that is the 14 years, which are 7 years of seals and 7 years of trumpets. Let me prove it out to you. This is just to show you there's a picture of it in the is. So now let's go to it and see what else we can understand about these 40 days. A lot of people have been confused over the years when it comes to why these things were said in Luke, Mark, and Matthew when Jesus gives this comparison to being as Jonah was. Because in Luke, he says he will be as Jonah was, which was a 40-day sign to this generation. But everybody thinks it was the resurrection of Christ that it meant. But it wasn't. This is prophecy. This has not yet been fulfilled. That's why when you go to Mark, and in Mark, it says, and as Jonah was, no sign will be given, and he leaves. And people say, see, that's a contradiction. And they say it's a contradiction because Luke says he would be as Jonah was. Matthew says he would be as Jonah was. But in Mark, he says no sign, and he leaves. When you understand that these are actually prophetic, and understand that these are signs and part of the pre, mid, and post, it will blow your mind. We're not going to go down this road except for you to understand that when he says he's going to be as Jonah was to this generation, he's speaking to the final generation, that he will fulfill 40 days as the Son of Man. As Jonah was, so shall Jesus warn. All right? We can prove it even more. In Luke chapter 17, listen to this. In Luke chapter 17, he's asked about the kingdom of God. When is this going to happen? When are they going to see it? They're asking him prophetically about the coming of the kingdom and the kingdom of God. And listen to what he tells them. Starting in verse 24 in Luke 17, he says, as the lightning that lighteth from one part under heaven and shineth unto the other part of heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in his day. So what is he telling them here? He's not telling them this is the start of his 40 days. He's telling them this is what it's going to be like when he returns feet down. And we see this exact same type of wording in Matthew chapter 24 and in Matthew chapter 28. So he's telling them what it's going to be like when he returns in his day, feet down. But now listen to what he says in Luke 17, 25. But first, listen to what but first means. It means firstly, before, at the beginning. It comes from the word G44:13, foremost, beginning. It comes from the G word 42:53, which is the primary word, which means prior to, superior, in front of. He says, but first must he suffer many things and be rejected of this generation. Again, the final generation. And as it was, and how do you know it's the final generation? Because they were just asking him about when the kingdom of heaven would come. When is this going to be? When is this end of days? And then he says, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days of the Son of Man. Now, a lot of people think this is the same one as Matthew chapter 24, but it's not. He's only talking about the 40 days. Listen to what he says next in verse 27. They did eat, they drank, they married wives and were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. He's talking about a period of time when he will be here as Jonah was for 40 days, warning, and it'll be during a time that is represented as the 40 days of Noah. Okay, so now we just got two places where he's talking about it in relation to this final generation. So now watch this. Let's go to Matthew chapter 24. And in Matthew chapter 24, how does the tribulation begin? Let's see what it says. We all know it, right? It starts in verse 7. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. And all these things are the beginnings of sorrows. Okay? So it's going to start at nation against nation. When we go to Mark, Mark's discourse tells us in chapter 13, something very similar, verse 8. For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. All red letter words by Jesus. So the tribulation begins at nation against nation. Well, let's see what Luke says. In Luke chapter 21, we read it differently. And you're going to notice a word that's going to jump out at you. In Luke chapter 21, starting in verse 10, listen to this. It starts with black letter words, like Luke saying, he's talking to them, like Mark and Matthew's groups. Then said he unto them, nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines and pestilences and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. So he's talking about things described in Mark and in Matthew. And listen to what he says next in verse 12. But before. Remember what he said in Luke 17? But first. Look at this, but first. Here was the root word of but before, or but first in Luke 17. Okay? 42:53. Look at what it is here. 42:53. Meaning what? Meaning before nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, these things are about to happen. What are these things? There's a group that's going to be taken. Some are going to be put to death. So this is even before nation against nation starts. And listen to what he says here in Luke chapter 20. There is no abomination in Luke 21 verse 20. There is no abomination of desolation as it tells us in Mark and in Matthew. Because this has nothing to do with the 7 years of seals or 7 years of trumpets. This is all that portion called above. Remember, Jesus says he would warn as Jonah would to this generation, meaning the final. Remember, he said it would be 40 days as it was with Jonah when the flood came. What was he supposed to do during those 40 days? Warn Jerusalem. Warn the people. Listen to what he says. And when they shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Let them that be in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. He's talking about nation against nation beginning, and when it begins at Jerusalem. But what happened before this? The pre-trib escape, the seven-day wedding, him now here for the 40 days when he's doing these warnings and doing signs. He's going to be doing incredible things while he's here. But what did it say in Luke 17? He's going to be rejected. He's going to be rejected because the world has no idea the Son of Man is coming for 40 days right before nation against nation. So when are these armies going to compass about? Because you see, he's warning that these armies are going to be compassing them about. They're not compassing them about or compassing Jerusalem about during the 40 days. He's warning that it's about to happen, and he's doing this warning during the 40 days. You see? So again, we're seeing this difference take place compared to Matthew and Mark. So now, what is this period of time? Let's go back, or let's go to Revelation chapter 6. In Revelation chapter 6, we read about the white horse rider. Well, let's get the white horse rider for a second and see what it says about when he opens the second seal and the red horse rider at Revelation 6, verse 4. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him there that sat thereon to take peace from the earth. What happens when peace, when the dove leaves, when peace is removed from the earth? Tribulation is going to begin. And what happens in this tribulation? That they should kill one another. What is nation against nation, people against people, city against city, neighbor against neighbor? They're going to kill one another. And there was given a great sword. Does that sound to you like nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, like Mark and Matthew's discourses begin? Absolutely, it does. So then what does that make the white horse rider if we just heard that the white horse rider is a period that happens before nation against nation, and it's described to us in Luke in chapter 21 when he's warning, in chapter 11 when he says he would warn as Jonah did, in chapter 17 that it would be 40 days like the time of the flood of Noah for the portion of 40 days? Who do you think the white horse rider is? It's the Son of Man. It's the Son of Man. And I'm going to prove it to you, because what we were talking about here is this ability to show the is that has here, there, a little bit here, a little bit there to reveal the end. But we also have the was that reveals it. And where do we have it in the was? Well, he told us about Noah. So if we go to the story of Noah, we're going to find out more. But I want to show you something before we get there. And that is what the Muslims have in their prophetic books about this character called the Dajjal. Al-Masih ad-Dajjal. This Dajjal character in Muslim scriptures is a person who comes for 40 days, who they call the Antichrist or the Christian Antichrist. Can you believe it? Do you know why Messiah said in Luke 17 that he would be rejected and refused during his 40 days as Noah's, while he's warning as Jonah did? Because the whole world thinks that Antichrist comes first. And the Muslims have been pre-told in their books that a character called the Dajjal, who is the Antichrist, false deceiver, he's the deceitful Messiah, is coming first for 40 days. Listen to this. It says he's going to do miracles, signs. Some Jews are going to follow, prostitutes, abandoned kids are going to follow him. But overall, he's going to be rejected. Listen to what they say about him. That the Dajjal appears and will stay for 40 days. Hello. If the Muslims are claiming that this Dajjal character is coming for 40 days and he is not their savior, he is their Antichrist, and they're trying to tell you that he is the Christian Antichrist, Who do you think he is? The enemy has pre-warned them in their books so that they don't, quote unquote, fall for him, so that they don't rush to him for salvation. Listen to this. Here are some of the prophecies. This is prophecies from their books. Listen to what it says. The Islamic prophecies listed are from multiple sources. They all come from the Quran, Hadith, Sunnah, and other Muslim sources. These are to show that, you know, their prophecies are very closely linked to the ones of the Bible, but they're always twisted to the wrong side. You see, their Antichrist that's coming, right? So who we call Antichrist and false prophet, they call their Mahdi and their prophet. So then who's this guy that comes first for 40 days that they call the Antichrist, that they call the Christian Antichrist, that they call their enemy? Who do you think he is? And when you go into look into things like this, what you find out is nobody has understood that the Son of Man is coming for 40 days in the above portion. And so everybody's going to be deceived, but few that knew no different that will come to realize who he is. All of this happens during the 40 days of the Son of Man, when the world is going to think he's the Antichrist. It's absolutely incredible. Now, let me show you something else. There is a biblical prophetic principle in Scripture that the day-year principle or year-for-a-day principle is a method of interpreting of Bible prophecy in which the word day in prophecy is considered to be a symbolic year. All right? Let me give you an example of this. We see that Enoch in Genesis chapter 5, that all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God and was not, for God took him. For Enoch, see, it's believed that Enoch was taken on the day that he was born. And so we have this 365 days as 365 years. Well, anybody who reads Scripture knows that we're trying to be like Enoch was, right? In Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verse 5 and 6, it says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. This is the pre-trib escape, like Enoch, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. But without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he that comes to God must believe that he is God, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. This is the picture of a bride, the Gentile bride of Christ. And look at what happens next. It's before the 40-day warning of God. Before the 40-day warning of God as Noah. How fitting is that? You see, so there's a great picture. And look at what it says about Enoch. This is from Chuck Missler, who's passed and gone to be with the Lord now. Listen to what it says about Enoch. Enoch is interesting in that rabbinical tradition that Enoch was born on the 6th of Sivan. Now, they call it the 6th of Sivan because they believe the 6th of Sivan is true Feast of Weeks. It's not. All right? It is not the true Feast of Weeks, but the picture is the Feast of Weeks. Enoch is an extremely interesting mystery in the Old Testament. The first prophecy by a prophet in the Bible is a prophecy of the second coming of Jesus Christ uttered by Enoch before the flood of Noah. Another tradition about Enoch is that he was translated or raptured on his birthday, the 6th of Sivan. Hello. This is what we're saying that I was talking about earlier. 50 days before Pentecost is the true Feast of Weeks, when two wave loaves of bread from the winter wheat harvest are brought in and then waved in the temple. So why am I showing you this? Well, one, it's showing you this picture of Enoch, which is connected to the true Feast of Weeks, that he was born and taken at the Feast of Weeks, and it was 365 years, and years could be days. The trick in this was always, or the mystery in this was always, in trying to understand, where is this 365 days? It's not a Gregorian 365, so What 365 is it? It's the Feast of Weeks, the true Feast of Weeks, but we're seeing this picture as years, as days. But we also have the typology of days as years. Now, let me show you this. We're going to go all the way back to Genesis. So I showed it to you in the is prophetically. Now I'm going to show it to you in the was for this portion, like 2 Corinthians 12, like John to Luke into Acts. And listen to what it says. Starting in Genesis chapter 4, verse 7. Listen to what it says. Chapter 7, verse 4. For yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain 40 days and 40 nights. Then we come down here, and it says in verse 10, and it came to pass after 7 days. So what were we talking about? The pre-trib bride is gone before the seven, okay? Then he returns after 7 days, which means the eighth day, just like John going into Luke chapter 24. He's here now for 40 days after seven. So that means the eighth day starts what? The 40 days of the flooding. Listen to what it says down here. In Genesis 16 and 17. And they that went in male and female of all flesh, as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. And the flood was 40 days. Remember the Son of Man, 40 days as Jonah was? Remember he said he would do it 40 days as the flood of the ark? And the flood was 40 days upon the earth, and the waters increased and bare up the ark and lifted up the ark above the earth. Okay, now listen to this. We go to chapter 8 of Genesis. Pay attention. This is directly connected to 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and what Paul was saying. Listen to this. In verse 6 of Genesis 8, and it came to pass at the end of 40 days. Okay, now we're at the end of those 40 days. So you had the seven, the pre-trib, the seven for the wedding. You had them in the ark for 40 days as the Son of Man being here. Now the 40 days come to an end, like at the end of Luke 24 or at the beginning of Acts chapter 1. And what happens? The Son of Man is now returning to heaven, and there's this group of his remnant workers that he had a meal with and served. They're now in Jerusalem waiting not many days for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And during the 40 days, remember in Luke 21, he was warning them when they see Jerusalem compassed to flee. Because the nation against nation will begin at the attack of Jerusalem that will destroy them and remove them from the land. Listen to what happens now. 40 days are over. There's about 3 days left. Soon as the 40 days are over, look at this. The raven is now sent out. Who is this raven? Well, have a look at this. There's the raven. It's dusky hue. Look at what the meaning of the word is. Arab. It's the darker complexion of the skin. It means Arab. So now you've got this Antichrist spirit going out. And what happens? We know Jerusalem now is about to be compassed about. We know through Revelation here in this ministry that it's going to be through Syria and those with Syria that will bring the destruction of Jerusalem. And what happens during this time while it's being compassed about? Look what happens next. In verse 8, and he sent out the dove from him to see if the waters had abated from off the face of the ground. So what do we have? Now we've got the end of 3 days being the 50th day at new wine, and the dove, the Holy Ghost is sent out. When the Holy Ghost is sent out, it's the anointing to that remnant group from Luke that will remain now during seals that are waiting for the anointing of the Holy Ghost of Acts chapter 2. When the Holy Ghost leaves, what happens? The attack on Jerusalem and the beginning of the 14 years. Want me to show you? Listen to this. Continuing in Genesis 8, verse 9. But the dove found no rest for the sole of her foot, and she returned unto him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. But he put forth his hand and took her and pulled her in unto the ark. Now listen to this. Verse 10. And he stayed yet 7 other days and again sent forth the dove out of the ark. Look at this. Stayed yet 7 more days. What did we see this prophetic picture? That years can be days and days can be years. So what are we looking at this? Well, the typology is to John, is to Paul in 2 Corinthians. So how much longer? 7 years. So 7 years later, we see the dove stayed, and then 7 years later comes forth. Look at this word stayed. The word stayed is the Hebrew word 2342. What did we say it starts? It begins the 14 years that starts with nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, the red horse rider, which will begin with the destruction of Jerusalem. And look at what this word means. Pain, travail, trouble. It's all about tribulation. It has nothing to do with staying or waiting. Hidden in the definition of the word is the beginning of tribulation. So what happens when the dove comes 7 days or 7 years later? Listen to verse 11. And the dove came into him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. Remember what happens to the great multitude rapture that was caught up? The word was caught up. The word rapture or harpazo means to pluck. And what were the Gentiles? Remember, the Gentiles are the ones who were grafted in. He didn't take the whole tree. He what? He had an olive leaf, which doesn't just mean leaf. It also means branch. So the wild olive branch, like you see in the picture here, this wild olive branch that was grafted in, the Gentiles that were grafted in are now plucked out. They are now harpazoed, plucked off. That's the seventh year of seals. Listen to what it says now in verse 12. And then he stayed yet 7 other days. It's the same wording, yet listen to what this one says. The word stayed is the Hebrew 3176. It just means to wait. Now he just waited and was patient. The first one meant tribulation. The second one means, okay, now he's just going to continue to wait for 7 more days as years. What are the chances that if you read this in scripture, you would have ever realized that this word actually meant tribulation and not simply to wait like the other one? Without having the Strong's Concordance at your fingertips, you would have never figured it out. This is the beginning of the 14 years at the Red Horse Rider Tribulation. This is the beginning of the 7 years of trumpets. And now it's just a period where he's called to wait 7 more days as years. And look at what happens in verse 13, when it's all done. And it came to pass in the 600th and first year, in the first month, in the first day of the month, he removed the covering of the ark and the ground was dry. What do you think this is a picture of? 600th year as 6,000th, first month, first day of the month, first year. This, brothers and sisters, is the confirmation in the was of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, where Paul was talking about a period above 14 years and then the 14 years. It's pictured here in the entire story of the ark in Genesis 7 and 8. It has the 7 days, the after 7 days, the 40 days, the not many days, which is the raven, then to the dove. Then when the dove leaves at the anointing, the 14 years of 7 and 7 begin, of which this after that, in that first 7, you have the rapture of the great multitude, which are the Gentiles grafted in, being plucked off in the great multitude rapture. And when the second 7 of 14 years is done, it's now the time of the millennial reign. The Lord has returned, destroyed the enemies, and it is now the time of his millennial reign. Brothers and sisters, I pray this blesses you. Take the time to seek it out. Take the time to understand it, discern it. Email with questions, comment under the video. Go to ministryrevealed.com. Watch more in this intro series, or visit the Ministry Revealed website and go through this intro series. I pray this blesses you and that you will share it with many others. God bless you. God bless your family. We'll talk to you soon. Bye for now.